We're going to discuss today my color palette. It's not even a set of colors. It is approach to colors and to mixing them. So let's begin. Let's talk about pigments now. The white, titanium white or lead white. Today I am going to use titanium white, but I also use this one, lead white number one from Rublev. This lead white is amazing. So we squeeze titanium now, and we need plenty of it as usual. The second one will be, let's put it here, King's blue. Actually, any kind of light blue will do the job. Latin yellow. Yellow ochre. Transparent yellow oxide. You can use Indian yellow if you like. Transparent red oxide. Now we go with this. This is vermilion, original vermilion, the real one. Alizarin. Ultramarine, red shade. But you can use ultramarine blue deep, for example, will work absolutely nice. Viridian. Bone black. You can use ivory black. Raw amber, burnt amber, this Antica green earth, which is technically terra verte. Okay, so this is the main construction of palette. I don't use all of them all the time. I can use just few of them, or all of them, or even more. The point is, we have yellow primary, red primary, and blue primary all the time. So technically, we need only three colors to mix, as we did with the Zorn palette. We used yellow ochre, we used vermilion, and we used bone black. The point is that I have few variations of yellow. Like, I have very high value, high chroma yellow, I have mid-tone yellow ochre yellow, and I have dark and transparent yellow oxide. All three, they are yellows for different purposes. I can work with in the lights using these yellows, and if I need to work in the darks, I can use Indian yellow, and I will show you how it works. So, transparent red oxide, vermilion, alizarin, they are all red primary. And you see, we have warmer red, lighter. We have cooler red, which is darker and transparent, and we have another extremely, extremely warm red, which is dark and transparent. So we can operate in both shadows and lights using these primaries, these reds and yellows and blues. We can operate with them without changing the values, and this is very important for the mixtures. So, now let's talk about the blue primary here. Ultramarine blue, Viridian, bone black, all of them, they are technically blue, especially this bone black and ultramarine. But you see, all of them, they're pretty dark. So if I need to add blue primary, I will rather use this King's blue, which is absolutely unbelievable shortcut in your mixtures. Finally, we have these three pigments here. Earth pigments. Raw amber, burnt amber, terra verte, antica green. You see how they work? They also three primaries. This is yellow primary, this is red primary, and this is blue primary. To a certain extent, it is a blue primary because it is cool. You see? If we mix it with white, we will see how cold this terra verte is. And now we mix with white this burnt amber. Kind of brown. And now we mix raw amber, more greener, yellower. We have even for very, very low chromatic situations, we have three primaries. So we have high chroma primaries, we have low chroma primaries, we have light value primaries, and we have dark value primaries. So you see, for every situation, we can choose our color. So if, let's say, on tight budget, or if you're just starting out, I would recommend to choose chromatic pigments because you can always knock down the saturation and chroma if you need to, just mixing them all together. But you cannot get good chroma out of these pigments. If you need chromatic yellow, but don't want to spend a lot of money, this one will work really good. This is yellow brown from Old Holland. It is way more powerful than yellow ochre. You see how rich light value mixture is with this color. So, but this pigment is very powerful. The same for reds. You can just buy cadmium red medium or just cadmium red light. But I recommend for beginning this one. This is Pirol red. Technically, it's a PR255. This one is Senilier red. And yes, alizarin, transparent red oxide, or burnt sienna if it is more accessible. Ultramarine, very cheap and powerful. Viridian and ivory black. So you using these colors, you can mix almost everything. Let's see how they work together. And if we talk about altering the color, so I mix something light, something like this. Let's say this color. And I mix something dark. So for the darks, we'll take this. Okay, this one. Even like that, I would say. So we have lights and darks, and imagine we need to change the color. Imagine the value is correct, but the color is not. Could you please make some comments about the toxicity of some pigments? What can I say? Don't eat them. Don't lick your fingers. Don't bring the food on your palette table. Don't bring the food in the studio at all. Be very careful. Wash your hands. If you tend to be messy painter, you know, like a lot of paint on your hands and so, use gloves. But the most important, just don't eat it. Okay, so if I need to change the temperature, or not temperature, the color, which is, yeah, like temperature. If I need to change the color, let's say this is too yellow, this is too orange. I need blue to compensate it. If I take any of these blues, I will drastically change the value. Let's say, you see what's going on. So I need to mix the blue out of bone black first. And in this case, I have quite similar blue in value. It is very pale blue, but still it is obviously the blue primary. So I can mix, and you see how much time I spent on matching the values. Okay, so if we need to change the temperature, to change the color, we rather add this, you see, King's blue, and it helps us to alter this orange into something more neutral. And this neutral mixes, they are essential for skin tones. We will talk about them. Maybe not today, maybe next time, but we will. So what is going on here? I need to change this dark. Let's say this is too green, and I think, okay, maybe I need to add some red to compensate the green. But if I add more red, the mixture is getting lighter and I don't want it. I want to change the color with this, with a transparent color, with the Indian yellow, or in this case, it's a transparent yellow oxide. And you see this green is getting less greener, it's getting more brown. Or I even can go with alizarin, which is also red. And I can change again the color of the shadow without changing the value of it. And if I work this way, I quickly create the pools on my palette, which provide me different versions of the same value. So I can jump back and forth into chroma, into the neutral, and back to chroma. So how Romber works, for example, it can be used to reduce both chroma and value, but in a very gentle way. Let's talk about the green.
Terre verte.
If we deal with a skin tone, for example, let's say something like that, the half tone, the light half tone in the cheeks, or maybe in the nose, but again, too chromatic. We can reduce it with a king's blue, sure, but we can also add this green into the mixture. And you see, it is so weak, so it is not altering anything. It just reduces the saturation without adding titanium white, because titanium white will bleach out the colors. Okay. So you see, I don't consider the black as black. I consider it as a blue. And it's all. I don't care about the black. I care about primaries only. Transparent red oxide. How do we use it in the darks? Because transparent red oxide is amazing for the darks. It is dark, it is warm, and it is transparent. We mix it with a complementary. So we can mix it with ultramarine, with ivory black, and with viridian. I prefer ultramarine or viridian because they both transparent, especially ultramarine. Now we have this dark brown, which is really good for any kind of shadows in the beginning. And also shadows are transparent. And using this mixture of two transparent colors gives us a lot of opportunities to paint thinly in the shadows and transparently. We have this brown and now we can alter it. If we add more green, it will be colder. So you see, I'm making it more and more neutral. With this brown. And with the transparent red oxide, I can keep it more brown. So you can constantly balance these two colors in order to quickly change the temperature. And if we want to see the actual hue, we should mix it with white. So you see what's going on here. And now you can see what's going on there. They look almost the same when they are without white, but with white, so much difference. You can just, if it went too cold, you just add more warm ingredient. If it is too warm, you add more cold ingredient. I think it's enough for today, for like introduction into palette and into organization.